So if you're ready, I'll get a drink and we'll hit the first one, ICD-10-CM and Fractures. Everybody have a little drink. One of the unique things about ICD-10 and Fractures is you're able to teach a lot of concepts in ICD-10 with Fractures, like an ICD, like an ICD-9, diabetes. We could use diabetes to bring out several scenarios and cases. So Fractures, there's some good points to bring up. Open fracture coding for ICD-10 uses a 7th character to explain the severity. So how do you determine the 7th factor? Let's go talk about that. Let's see if this is going to be smooth for me. There we go. Let's see if I can get this out of the way. Okay. I'm not as smooth as this as Lorraine is, so you'll have to bear with me. ICD-10, 7th character with fractures. Now, the one thing that most of you probably already know if you're working with ICD-10 is the fact that you're able to have up to 7 characters, and they're not called digits like they were with ICD-9. They're called characters. So the 7th is going to be that last digit. Usually it is to indicate whether it's an initial encounter or a subsequent encounter, or maybe sequela, which stands for late effect. But with the fractures, this 7th character not only tells if it's an initial encounter or a subsequent encounter, it also is going to use a classification system called the Gustilo-Anderson Classification System, and it gives you 2 vital pieces of information. One is, what's the likelihood of your patient developing an infection because it's an open fracture? Now, if you're not familiar with the difference between a closed and open fracture is an open, it simply means the skin is open. There is an open wound, and most of the time, the bone has caused that, has poked through, leaving the window for, or the door for infection. And because the bones run out throughout your entire body, if you get an infection in the bone and the blood, you've got blood parts that are made in the bone marrow, it can be a really big time bad thing real fast. So it's something that they take seriously and they're very cautious with. So one, what's the likelihood that this is going to cause an infection? And second, how long is it going to take for that fracture to heal? Now, you know, there's kind of a standard on fractures. You know, if it's a just a simple fracture, but if it's a compound or an open fracture, chances are you're looking at pins and things and some surgery to debride or clean that area up. So it could take a little bit longer. It usually means it's a more severe fracture if it's actually broken through the skin. Okay, so as the grade goes up on this classification system, the infection rate rises dramatically at the time and for the lengthens the time for the fracture to heal. Because, you know, most of the time, a person doesn't have to take antibiotics if they've got a fracture. But if you've got an open fracture, you're most likely to be on antibiotics. So grade 1 of an open fracture injury, let's say of the tibia, has less than 2% infection rate with proper treatment and takes an average of about 4 to 5 months to heal. But if you move down into grade 3B and 3C, which I'm going to break these down for you, fractures have up to a 50% infection rate and takes an average of 8 to 9 months for the bone to heal. You know, that's a huge difference. Now, so let's see what divides those types up. So type 1 is simply that the wound is 1 centimeter. Okay. Then you've got type 2 is 1 to 10 centimeters. Now, we're talking centimeters, not inches. So keep that in mind. Then type 3A, we have greater than 10 centimeters, high energy, meaning it was a high energy break, the impact, or however you want to say that, and adequate tissue for coverage. There's adequate tissue to cover and stitch that all back up for that open wound. Now you get into type 3B, extensive peristeal stripping and requires free soft tissue transfer. Okay, now this is much more intense. Then we have type 3C, vascular injury requiring vascular repair. Now, again, you can see why 50% infection rate, and it takes 8 to 9 months for the bone to heal, that much more severe break, much more complex wound. So let's see an example down below. Okay, this code here, S82.101B, with B being our seventh character, is the code that we'll use for this case. Mrs. Green is brought into the emergency room department with an open fracture of the right lower leg. X-rays revealed tibial break. The patient's husband stated he saw exposed bone, then it went away. There is an open wound of 5 centimeters in length, 3 inches distal to the knee. An orthopedic consult has been ordered. So we're just worried about the diagnosis, not whether, you know, it's inpatient ER and all this other stuff. We're just going to talk about the break itself. Okay, so we have an unspecified fracture because we don't know what type of a fracture, meaning was it a spiral fracture, was it a compound fracture, was it a green stick fracture. All of those type of fractures are listed in your ICD-10, not in the ICD-9. So unspecified fracture of the upper end of right tibia, initial encounter, because this is the first time they came into the ER, for open fracture, and we know it's an open fracture because the husband stated he saw the bone and then it went back in, which is common for open fractures. Type 1 or type 2, which it's 5 centimeters, which means that up here when we looked at this, we were between 1 and 10 centimeters, so it is a number 2. And initial encounter, again, for open wound fracture not otherwise specified. This is in little print in your books. So if you go in and look at S82.101 in your tabular of your ICD-10, you'll see this fracture. Now, this is not really a good picture of that because this is not a 5 centimeter wound, but that gives you an idea of what we're talking about here, where that wound is. The appropriate seventh character is to be added to all codes from category S82. Now, this is S82 because it's, look, S82 right there, unless otherwise indicated. And this right here is a breakdown of that category. This is on page, if you have the 2014 ICD-10 draft, it's going to be on page 899. Just happened to note that. But this states B, initial encounter for open fracture, type 1 or 2, initial encounter for open fracture, not otherwise specified. And I just happen to have a document camera of that. Let's see if I can get that to slide over. I may have to make it small here. We'll just get a look at this. Okay, so this is what this looks like. Here is our S82, you know, and it tells you, what was our code again? S82, was it? Oh, there. Anyway, fracture of upper end of tibia. We have the right side, unspecified fracture, meaning it's not displaced, it's not non-displaced. Look at it, and these different types. It is unspecified fracture of upper end of right tibia. We know it's the upper end because that was explained. S82.101, and then we're shown here that we have to have a seventh character. So this directs us over here. Seventh character right here. The appropriate seventh character is to be added to all codes from category S82. So if it starts with S82, you're going to have a seventh character. So when you're testing, if you get right here and you see this little box that says, you know, check for the seventh character, and it doesn't have one, then it is not the right answer. And we went with B, initial encounter for open fracture type 1 or 2, and it's initial encounter. It would be also for initial encounter for open fracture not otherwise specified. Now, when you look here, look at how many choices you have. And it gets all the way down from initial encounter, subsequent encounter, sequela, meaning late effect. But you can have subsequent encounter for an open fracture type, you know, and then shows those with malunion, meaning that the bone is not going together well, and then here is non-union. Non-union, malunion, okay? So that's what it looks like in the ICD-10 draft. One more thing I wanted to know before we went to the next slide. See this notation? We've got S82. We know we're in the right area. But a fracture not indicated as displaced or non-displaced should be coded as displaced. That is a guideline. You need to know that. You don't have to have it memorized. You just need to know that if you're in this area and there's a note, you better read it. And then it includes, and then the excludes. So make a point to pay attention to those, okay? Okay, so that's it for that slide.
Get more CPC exam tips, coding certification training, and CEU credits. Go to www.codingcertification.org.